Welcome. Thank you for your patience today. On behalf of President Stephen Sample and our Provost Max Nikias, welcome to University of Southern California. USC is the home of the CREATE Homeland Security Center, and we are proud to be a partner with the Department of Homeland Security in its mission to make this nation safer and more secure. Like all Americans, we at USC were shocked by the attacks that took place on September 11th, and we were resolved to help reduce the threat of terrorism in this country. When the opportunity arose 4 years ago this summer, we joined 71 other universities around this nation in a competition to become the very first University Center of Excellence in Homeland Security. We competed for this award because, as a university, we are committed to capturing the imagination of our students and faculty toward addressing our most critical societal issues, such as terrorism. At its heart, the CREATE Center is two things. It is the Center for Risk and Economic Analysis of Terrorism Events, a long name explaining that we create the tools for analyzing objective decisions in allocating funding and counterterrorism strategies in the benefit of Homeland Security. And then CREATE is also CREATE, meaning it's a place where we help anticipate and prevent terrorism through the imaginative powers of the university. And now, with great pleasure, I would like to introduce a leading congressional expert on terrorism, homeland security, and foreign affairs. Jane Harmon was first elected in 1992 to represent California's 36th congressional district in Los Angeles, South Bay, and Marina Del Rey, home of the Information Sciences Institute and the Institute for Creative Technologies, part of USC. Representative Harmon is chair of the House Intelligence, Information Sharing, and Terrorism Risk Assessment Subcommittee, and she serves on the Energy and Commerce Committee. In 2006, Harmon completed 8 years of service on the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence, the final four as ranking member, where she played a lead role in the creation and passage of the Intelligence Reform Act of 2004. And I might add that Jane Harmon is a very good friend of the university and also a USC mother of a student. Please join me in welcoming a great leader in the fight to protect our homeland security, Representative Jane Harmon.
Good afternoon. I was worried that that introduction might leave out the fact that I'm a USC mom, and a very proud one at that. You bet. It also left out one other thing, not that it wasn't a good introduction and I appreciate all the praise, but that is that I have a very close working relationship with another member of Congress who's sitting in the front row in a gorgeous yellow jacket, Diane Watson. And it was Diane who approached a number of us just a few days ago after the new National Intelligence Estimate on Terrorism came out, and she said, you know, if our homeland is more at risk, and oh, by the way, I think it is, which is why it's so critical that a group like you exists and that Michael Chertoff is out for his third visit to talk to you and talk to us. But if our homeland is more at risk, don't you think the members of Congress from the Los Angeles region ought to convene a meeting to talk about what these risks are so that the public will really understand? And she's right. And this is just typical of Diane. Day in and day out, she always puts the people first. And I'm very proud to be her sister. And I'm very proud, and you should be very proud, that she represents this extraordinary education institution. So Diane, thank you for everything you do. Harry Truman said, if you want a friend in Washington, get a dog. Well, there are exceptions. Michael Chertoff has become my friend and my partner, and I believe that our bipartisan collaboration over the 3 years that he served as secretary has made a difference. In addition to the task of organizing what were once 23 separate agencies into a coherent department, Secretary Chertoff has the job of allocating the federal government's limited resources, human and financial, to cities and towns across our nation to keep all of us safe. Recently, the Department of Homeland Security released its Urban Area Security Initiative, so-called UASI, grant awards. Though our area received fewer dollars, something I'm sure you're all aware of, than it did last year when we got a higher percentage than New York or Washington, D.C., I do want to tell you that the formula that is being used, which I have reviewed carefully, is a sound one. Not all regions of the country face the same risks. Cities like Los Angeles and New York are at the top of the terrorist target list, and we deserve a greater share of security investments. Though our share decreased this year, I believe we remain in the top tier, and I believe that future years will send more dollars our way, and oh yes, we need them. Let's not forget what's at risk. The Port of Los Angeles and Long Beach, which the Secretary and I and several members of Congress visited this morning, moves almost 50% of the nation's container traffic. It's really the Port of Chicago, if you think about it, because a lot of that traffic goes on a semi-submerged rail bed through the Alameda Corridor and out into the country. I don't mean just Chicago. It's the Port of St. Louis. It's the Port of Central United States. And even some of the things entering our ports from Asia go all the way to the East Coast. We also have LAX, which has twice been an intended Al-Qaeda target. Our movie studios and theme parks are national cultural icons. And we have, as you all know, some of the nation's premier universities, though only one of them has a really top-tier football team. Keeping this city safe and this region requires layered strategies. I'm proud of roles that I played, and I know that Diane was supportive of this too, in the drafting and passage of the Safe Port Act, intelligence reform, and the creation of the Department of Homeland Security. But there are still huge gaps, one of which is in the area of interoperable communications. UASI grants are one thing, but we've had conversations earlier today about the way that grants were just made for the Los Angeles region for interoperable communications. We received $22 million out of the $94 million that came to California, a piece of the $1 billion that's just been distributed. These grants are not a welfare program. They are a program that should be targeted at building the infrastructure necessary to permit communities like this, the most at-risk communities, to communicate with each other in times of a terror attack or a huge natural disaster. We've seen the problem. On 9/11 in New York, firefighters were going up the stairs in those two towers when the towers were glowing red. They didn't know that, but the NYPD did, and the NYPD was in helicopters circling overhead, trying frantically to reach the firefighters. Problem, no interoperable communications. And we've seen with our large wildfires here that fire departments, no kidding, drive around the fires to swap radios. There are bridging technologies. It is true that we can integrate 12 to 20 different frequencies, but that's not going to be good enough if something seriously dangerous happens here and happens in San Francisco, perhaps in a near simultaneous fashion. So there's a lot of work to do. Congress is on the case. It's partly money to cities and regions. It's also partly a problem for Congress and the Federal Communication Commission in setting aside, finally, some dedicated spectrum, the 700 megahertz band, so that all these different areas can use shared spectrum for emergency communications. Well, these are just some of the issues that matter. My bottom line is that it helps to have a partner in Washington, not just a dog. And so it's with great pleasure that I introduce a man who I think works at this all the time and who comes to this region frequently because he knows that we have some of the biggest problems and some of the most talent. To use a controversial word in the intelligence business, but I think it applies here, I would say it's a slam dunk that there would be a center of excellence at this incredible university. And I think it is a huge opportunity and a great honor that Secretary of Homeland Security Michael Chertoff is here to talk to us this afternoon. And it's my pleasure to introduce Michael Chertoff.
Well, I want to thank Jane for that wonderful introduction. I don't have the connection to USC that Jane has because I'm not a USC parent. But I guess I feel I do have a connection because, like Jane, I went to the USC of the East, Harvard. So the weather was not quite as good, however. I also want to recognize Steve Gross from the Homeland Security Advisory Council. Elizabeth Garrett, who greeted me, who's the acting provost, and a whole host of other people who are part of CREATE, which, of course, is our first center of excellence here at USC. When we look at the issue of terrorism and homeland security, and we try to estimate what our advantages are and our resources are as we stack them up against the enemy, we come to quickly realize that one of our great resources is the value add of our technology and innovation. And a key component of that strength for the country is the quality of the nation's research universities. And that's why it's been so important to Homeland Security that a number of our leading universities have worked with us to create Homeland Security Centers of Excellence in the post-9/11 world. I'm delighted that we're able to fund these Centers of Excellence, including our very first center right here at USC, the Center for Risk and Economic Analysis of Terrorism Events, or, because inevitably everything has to have an acronym, CREATE. I'm also pleased that this past spring we were able to give the program an $11 million three-year grant renewal. Now, what is CREATE? CREATE brings together some of the finest thinkers and researchers to help us analyze what we need to know in the fight against terrorism. Using advanced modeling tools, these remarkable people are helping us to assess the risks of terrorism in a disciplined way, gauge the economic consequences of a terrorist attack, and to evaluate strategies for making us safer and more secure. This is the kind of risk-managed, cost-benefit approach that is needed to help us prevent the kind of attack we suffered on September 11th, but to make sure that we don't overreact or overinvest or so cripple ourselves with security that we wind up giving the enemy the very victory that it seeks. In fact, it was Osama bin Laden himself who spoke about the 9/11 attacks in terms of their cost-benefit. In a posting on the Al Jazeera website in November 2004, which happens to have been the same year this Center of Excellence was launched, bin Laden said that while al-Qaeda had spent $500,000 on the 9/11 attacks, his organization inflicted more than $500 billion in economic damage. He concluded that every dollar that his terrorist group spent, and here I'm quoting, quote, defeated $1 million, besides the loss of a huge number of jobs, close quote. Those are bin Laden's words, not mine. So he saw his strategy in terms of cost benefit, and it's important for us to bear that in mind. Programs like CREATE help us frustrate the plans of terrorists who want to destroy our economy and our way of life. And therefore, I'm pleased that CREATE has taken a leadership role in forging alliances with other centers of excellence and with other universities to tackle complicated problems and challenges raised by the threat of terrorism. Let me just give you a few examples. A major economic analysis coinciding with last year's bioterrorism risk assessment report to the president, informing the national policy about the costs and the consequences of biological attacks and countermeasures. Training for our immigration and customs enforcement agents to help them assess the risks of people and goods coming across our borders. A cost-benefit analysis about the costs and benefits of installing certain measures to prevent shoulder-fired missiles from attacking our commercial aircraft. Modeling the cost analysis of closing the border, if we were to try to do that to stop avian flu. Assessing the probability of successful terrorist attacks in a variety of scenarios, and particularly close to the heart of people in this area, an assessment of the economic consequences of closing the ports of Long Beach and Los Angeles in the wake of a dirty bomb attack. And talking about the port here, earlier today I had the opportunity of being with Congresswoman Harmon and others to speak at the Port of Los Angeles, which is the busiest port in our country. 44% of all U.S. imports enter through the ports of Los Angeles and Long Beach, which amounts to $295 billion of economic activity. And that number should tell us just how critical our ports are to the life of our country and our nation's economic well-being. No doubt if terrorists wanted to strike at our economy, then one of the ways they could do so that would be very harmful from a cost-benefit perspective would be to attack the essential vehicles for commerce and trade, including those at the port. And that is the need for port security. So the question then becomes, what do we do to secure the vital infrastructure at our ports, as well as the cargo that flows through the ports, but also in a way that doesn't destroy the ports themselves? And let me begin by citing three key principles that we apply to this task. First, we believe in partnership. Port security has to mean partnership between government and the private sector. Why? Well, government doesn't own or manage most of the ports in this country. The private sector does. Most of the infrastructure is owned by the private sector, and most of the people work for the private sector. So when we're talking about ports, we're talking about commerce, a lot of which is really operated by and supervised by the private sector. So we need to have public-private cooperation. Second principle, risk management. Risk management does not mean risk elimination. There is no such thing in life as risk elimination. In fact, if we tried to eliminate every risk, we simply couldn't do it. Moreover, to even get close to total risk elimination, we'd have to be so heavy-handed about security that we'd wind up costing the economy an astronomical amount of money, and we'd wind up destroying the very thing we were trying to protect. Perfect example of this is the argument that sometimes is heard, although not so much lately, that we ought to inspect physically every single container that comes into the ports of this country. And of course, whenever I hear that suggestion made, I say, well, if we were to do that, the lines would be backed up from here to the overseas port of departure. And very quickly, we wouldn't have a security problem because all the trade would leave the United States and go elsewhere, to Canada and Mexico, and therefore we wouldn't have a port security problem because we wouldn't have any ports. That's not a clever way to deal with this issue. What risk management allows us to do is to identify what are the greatest risks, highest threat, weakest vulnerability, and most significant consequence. Look at how we can address those threats in a cost-benefit way, and then take steps to mitigate the consequences, but only to the extent that, from a cost-benefit standpoint, it makes sense. Now, this doesn't lend itself to a soundbite, but it is actually the only reasonable and disciplined approach to doing the job without crippling ourselves, bankrupting ourselves, or tying ourselves up in knots. The third principle is a layered approach to security. That's a recognition that no single system is perfect. Human error is, of course, always a possibility. And so it is a system of systems that is the best way in which to truly get the maximum amount of security. These principles, partnership, risk management, and layered defense, are consistent with what, of course, the CREATE Center of Excellence is all about. And it's the principle that we're using to secure our ports in our homeland. Let me talk a little bit then about how we apply the principles in real life to the protection of the ports. We recognize there are two general threats to the safety of our ports here in Los Angeles and Long Beach and all over the country. First, we have to worry about dangerous things getting into the ports. And second, we have to make sure that there's not a direct attack on the infrastructure of the ports. So how do we keep dangerous things, dangerous cargo, from entering our ports and either causing damage at the port or passing through to cause damage elsewhere in the country? Well, the best place to start is overseas, where you first begin the process of loading up the containers of the cargo to be brought into the United States. And in keeping with our principle of partnership, we've created a public, private, and international partnership with more than 7,000 businesses, including most of the largest U.S. importers. Through our Customs Trade Partnership Against Terrorism, or CTPAT, we're reviewing the security practices not only of the companies shipping the goods, but of the companies that provide them with services. With respect to the cargo itself, we gather information and we screen every container before it comes into the country. And now I have to explain what I mean by screening. I don't mean we physically open every container, because as I've explained, we can't do that. What I do mean is we require and obtain information about every incoming shipment, including the content, manifest, shipping history, and other data. We marry that together with intelligence that we gather from all kinds of sources about people all over the world, and we conduct information-based targeting, where we identify those containers that are a high risk, and those are the ones we do actually open and inspect. We do a lot of that overseas through our Container Security Initiative, in which we deploy our officers in foreign ports. The rest of it is done here. And in any case, the officers physically inspect any container that we've designated as high-risk cargo using smart risk management and intelligence. That's another layer of defense, but we have a third layer. We want to have an automated way of detecting radioactive material, which is the worst kind of weapon of mass destruction, if it comes through the containers. So what we do is we use radiation scanning equipment. Now, if we can do this overseas, that's great. And part of what we're doing in keeping with the Safe Ports Act that was passed overwhelmingly by Congress last year, thanks to some very hard work by Congresswoman Harmon and others, we've got six overseas ports in which we're now conducting integrated radioactive passive monitoring and active X-ray interrogation to determine whether there are dangerous nuclear materials coming into containers, even before those containers are loaded on ships to come to the United States. We intend and hope to do more of this, although it obviously requires the cooperation of our foreign counterparts and the physical capability to conduct it in ports overseas. For those that are not scanned overseas, by the end of this year, we will be putting virtually 100% of the containers through radiation portal monitors at the ports here in the United States, so that by the time those containers leave to enter the interior, they will all have been scanned as well as screened. Now, let me stand back and make a couple of points about this effort. First of all, regarding this entire strategy, which we call the Secure Freight Initiative, it's a terrific example of how international cooperation can help secure the supply chain, because we work with our partners in the public domain and in the private sector to elevate the security. Second, it explains a little bit more precisely and perhaps in more concrete terms a critical distinction that runs through almost everything that we do, the difference between intelligence-based screening and automated or mechanical-based scanning. When we scan an item, cargo, or for example, if we scan a bag at the airport, what we're seeking to do is use an automated method to identify a dangerous item. But when we screen something, we either screen a container or we screen a passenger, we're using intelligence-based risk-modeled characteristics to identify those individuals or those items that are higher risk and which we therefore ought to take a close look at. It's the combination of screening and scanning, automated interrogation, but also risk-driven, particular focus on high-risk people and things, that creates a comprehensive approach to security that maximizes what we do without imposing too much cost for too little benefit. Again, we do not, as I say, ever intend to physically inspect every single piece of cargo, any more than we intend to physically strip search every single person who gets on an airplane. I know you'll be relieved to hear that, because the delays are long enough as they are. But we don't do that precisely because they are the cost well outweighs the benefit. And it's the intelligent application of the kinds of modeling that is generated from places like CREATE that allows us to make the intelligent strategic choices about how to screen and scan. Now, where are we going with this? Well, as I say, we have gone from 5 years ago at a point where we had no radiation scanning portal monitors at our ports of entry, zero, to where we will be at the end of this year and at the end of next year. We have installed our 1,000th radiation portal monitor very recently. By the end of this year, almost every container coming through a seaport is going to go through radiation portal monitors, and by the end of next year, almost every land port of entry is going to scan all of its containers coming in for radiation. That's going to be basically going from zero to virtually 100% by the end of 2008. And then we're not going to rest there, because we're only using the first generation of scanning equipment that we're currently deploying. We need to take it to the next level. And that next level, I'm hopeful to say, will be advanced spectroscopic portals. These portals, known as ASPs, are designed to automatically and more precisely discriminate between naturally occurring radioactive material and dangerous nuclear material that poses a threat, separating between granite and kitty litter, which emit a certain amount of natural radiation, and a nuclear bomb or a dirty bomb, which obviously would pose a different kind of threat. With this kind of enhanced and more precise detection, which we're currently testing, we will not only be able to get more precise readings and focus more quickly on the really dangerous cargo, but we'll also improve the efficiency of the scanning process overall, which is going to speed it up and make the ports more efficient and help them achieve the results they need. To give you an example, currently, anytime a container under the current system activates an alarm, it actually has to be examined and the material looked at to see if it poses a threat. And on an average day, the ports of LA and Long Beach experience between 400 and 600 alarms. So that's a lot of delay. When the ASP system is tested and ready to be deployed, it will significantly reduce that number. So these systems have the promise for further increasing our security and also increasing our efficiency. Obviously, it's critical that we complete additional field testing and rigorous certification measures in the real world, meaning not just in the lab, but out day in, day out, good weather.